So a few people are still coming in, but I guess we can start. So welcome everyone to my session here at Buzzwords. It will be about real-time deduplication using Storm and React. And actually, my main interest in giving this talk is to basically talk a bit about data deduplication, show or inspire you to look a bit into the field, and basically to show that there are interesting ideas that you can find there and that it might be a topic that it's worth to put another look in. So, but before we start, let me introduce myself shortly. My name is Stefan Schadwinkel. I work for a Hamburg-based consultancy agency, and basically we are offering services in the core domains of complex web applications. But let's get started with the duplicate data. So why is it interesting? Basically, it all starts with databases. So there you might have the problems of two companies fuse and you have two databases and you have the same customer and he might have moved in between and so you have to consolidate it. So that's the main historic starting point for the topic, but that's actually not what me interests most. So one topic where I had some past experience with, where I had some challenges, were basically fraud detection. So there you have people who create a lot of accounts that are not exactly identical, but it's the same thing which is behind it. And what we did there, we basically ended up indexing all the stuff in Apache Solr and then had a manual process to query the data. All fine, but there could be some improvements to that. So another topic which is closely related to that would be fingerprinting. There, I'm not a big fan of using persistent cookies like using Flash or writing to the disk of users and so on, and that's all not so nice. However, people change their systems, install some other browser plugins, so if you do just some device fingerprinting, you might have small changes in there, but still have the same device. And then those two topics, where it really comes down to is velocity. If you have a few similar registrations, which might be totally legitimate, if you just have an increase in like dozens of that appear at some moment, then you have something you want to look into. And that's actually one question we pondered along. There might be some use to the system I will show later to tackle this question. It's not the total solution to that, but that's one of the problems I'm interested in. And if you look a bit further, another topic I'm interested in is sequence tracking. And it fits into the whole topic because it has a very interesting interpretation. With the former topics, what we are interested in is one specific entity behind slightly different data points. With sequence tracking, that entity might actually be some kind of behavior. So people might do the same stuff or might have the same intention using some product or some website, but they might not do exactly all do the same steps. So there might be some fuzziness about it. And so if we look at all these topics as whole, we basically come to the conclusion, well, it's a clustering issue. However, the problem with clustering is that it's super expensive. So in the end, we would have to do pairwise comparisons yielding such a distance matrix, which is the base for many clustering algorithms. But oh, that's too far. But if you have really millions of users and you want to have some real-time tracking on that, you cannot just recompute this matrix all the time. So I'm also not a super big expert in the whole topic of data deduplication, but I came recently interested in the topic. And when you become interested into the topic, you are faced with something like that. So there's a deduplication task you have to solve in order to get into the field, because multiple communities like the statistics, the machine learning community, and the database community, they all use a lot of different terms to describe basically the same process. So it started with record linkage, but there are fancy words like merge purge, database hardening, what have you, entity matching, and so on and so forth. So here are some comments, mainly from Wikipedia, on what's the definition behind those methods. And it's basically about finding the same entity behind data points. However, a problem is they may not share a common identifier, have different storage locations, you have a different style in the data, and you might lack standard formats. And basically, what has also happened over the last decade or so is that NoSQL databases and Hadoop did not actually solve that issue. They just made it worse. So we have more data, and it's becoming more diverse every day. And basically, we cannot expect that the web will ever produce just one similar type of data. So if you should be interested to follow more into what's going on in the field, there's an actually good overview in this paper from Elmar Gamid and his colleagues from 2007. And one point also to stress is that it's actually a topic where a lot of ongoing research is done. Many issues are not solved. And so there's quite a big opportunity to find interesting methods which you can then also apply to other problems. And as you can see, the original thinkings about the problem were done in the 40s and 50s. They were formalized in the late 60s and 70s, and since the 90s, there's machine learning also applied to it. And basically, what you do is you look at what features do my data sets have, you define some way to match or compare them. There's several methods, n-grams, token-based things, phonetic encodings, and so on. You define a weight or an importance for that, and then you calculate it. And basically, what machine learning helps you to do there is to find those weights. It does in no way help you with the distance metrics. And because if you have big databases and you want to create just this distance metrics once, it still is, if you have many features, much too heavy and much too expensive. So what's done there is called blocking, which is just the same as data partitioning. And so you, for instance, just do the comparisons within one country. However, people might move, so you might do this multiple times. And so you have a few passes. However, you must really look into your data. You must have someone who understands it, who tries several methods, who evaluates the matchings, who looks in, oh, what did not match, what do I know about the data, and so on. And it's a lot of craft work. So there's really no general method you can just automatically apply to that, which makes it even more expensive to do it. And there's the distance metrics. So one project I want to highlight, because I didn't know it I only know about it for a few weeks or a few months. It's called DDoop. It's a research project from Leipzig University. I'm actually not involved with it, but I find it interesting. And you can read more on their website. And I just want to mention it because basically what it is, it's an environment where you can try multiple matching strategies, where you can choose different matching operators, create experiments, run them in Hadoop, evaluate them, and then say, okay, for my database matching problem, this is my solution. And they are also doing current research. One is on load balancing, because if you partition the data, the partitions will not be of the same size. And if you do only a few multiple passes, you will end up doing some comparisons multiple times, and they try to minimize that. So that's basically the main approach in the whole field. Here's a screenshot of it, so you get an idea on how what it looks like, can select your data and your operators and so on, so check it out. However, that's after we've introduced basically the topic, I want to focus on this one specific algorithm, which I find highly interesting. And basically, it's not my invention, I read about it in the Eventbrite engineering blog, actually. So many thanks to Jay Shen, who wrote the article. However, one thing to notice about that is that it's based on research done at universities, research done by other people, which was then just cleverly combined. And the main points of the algorithm is that you transform your data using hashing, and then you create an indexing scheme to have a fast lookup. And so now I will try to walk you a bit through the algorithm. Unfortunately, due to the time, it will be a bit fast, so I hope you get a general idea and know what it looks like. So first, how do we compare or calculate the distance for this algorithm? We basically used the Jacquard similarity coefficient, which is basically if we have some text, we can tokenize it, and then we can say, okay, we have the total set of tokens, how many are in both sentences, and then we say, okay, for this example, 3 tokens are the same, so we have a match of 27%. Now, if we should hash it, and I come in a second to do on how to do that, we might have a set of hashes instead of the actual tokens. And we can then approximate the similarity by simply counting how many of these hashes are identical between the two data points. Then we divide this by the number of hashes we have, and let's say we would have 10 of 32 hashes to match, we would have a similarity of 31%. So how do we get the hashes? That's actually done by minhash, just as a short recap. You hash all your tokens with one function, take the minimum hash, and then you do this n times with different hash functions. The nice thing about this is that if you want to match free text, you get, after this transformation, this exact same amount of hashes for every text. So you don't have to worry about different sizes of the text and so on. Of course, it will have some skew if you have many small and some big message and so on. But generally, you don't have to care on how many tokens your data points actually have. So, because we then have only to compare these hashes, we already reduced some of the price. We did not care about the distance metrics yet. But we can reduce this price further, because actually we are not interested in knowing the hash. What we are interested in is, do these hashes match? And that's all we care about. And if we observe one bit that is different between two hashes, we know that the hashes cannot match. So what we can do is, we can just keep one bit of the whole hash and use that. So of course, using the least significant bit, because it changes the fastest to do this, we will at random say in 50% of the cases there's a match while there is no. However, because we know this is a fixed probability, we can just adjust for it later on. So that was basically the first part. The second part of the algorithm is to now index that sample of bits. And that's basically based on a method which was published in 2012, so it's also fairly recent. Which is done by Nurusi and his colleagues and is called Fast Search in Hamming Space. You can read more on the links on their research. It's really interesting. You should have a look there. And it's basically based on the pigeonhole principle, which is should be a well-known mathematical principle. In short, if you have a fixed amount of positions and a number of items to put in there, there are a few constraints which will always be met. One is that in this instance, if you have 10 items and you put them in 9 positions, you have at least one position that will have at least 2 items, because there's no other way but to put the last item. You can then also shuffle this around, and in the end, you come to a second constraint, which says, okay, there must also be one position which has at least one item or none. And then you can generalize this to a general case. So now, that principle we can now basically use to make our search faster. And basically, as a short recap, we start with 32 hash functions. We keep only the lowest or the least significant bit, so we have one 32-bit number. And if we then say, okay, we need 90% match of that hash sample, then we know we have 4 unequal bits at most. And if we now split our 32-bit sample in a few chunks, we can use the pigeonhole principle to say where is this 1 or 0 unequal bits. So basically, if we use 4 chunks in this case, then one chunk must be totally equal or just differ by 1 bit. And we can then use this to create a mapping scheme where we basically use each chunk as a key and have a list behind it with the whole 32 bits of all hash samples which have that chunk. And so we have to store our bit sample multiple times, and we have to trade some space for time saving. Now, when we want to do the lookup, we could say, okay, we just have to query the chunk. This is true in some sense, but because the bit distance can be one bit that is unequal, we actually have to create all the chunks that differ by 1 bit and query them as well. So that's basically what's said in that slide. So when we do the lookup, we create all the hashes and the bit sample, and then we query. The interesting thing is that once we have one chunk and it's 1 bit distant siblings, and we find candidates which we then need to do the real comparison on, then we can stop, because we know that we have at least one of those chunks where only 0 or 1 bit is unequal. And we have stored it multiple times, so we can stop querying once we have found a candidate set. So let's have a short recap on what this does tell us about performance. Basically, if you have m messages we want to compare, and n is the number of hash functions, and k is the number of chunks we split it into, then we can see, okay, if we just care about the total number of messages, then we can more or less insert in constant time. If you use a hash, that can be done. If you use a database, this might be a bit different, but it's a rather inexpensive operation. Of course, it will not be super fast because you have always to calculate all the hashes, but at least it's bounded. The same is for the lookup. We have a fixed set. Once we fix n and k, we have a fixed set of chunks we need to look up. Database lookup might be a bit, might scale a bit, but it's not really relevant for this discussion. And what is interesting is what happens to our quadratic pairwise comparisons. And it turns out that the amount of candidates is actually bounded by the total number of messages divided by 2 to the power of n divided by k. And this, in sum, means that if we choose these numbers correctly and they become much bigger, or that number becomes much bigger than m, then in this, I don't have a pointer, in this equation, this value becomes 1 or less than 1, and we can then scale it linearly. So I personally found this very interesting when I read it, so that's the main point why I show it to you. And finally, we can get rid of that distance matrix. So, as I wanted to try it out, I built a small prototype using Storm and React, and I'm just walking you through some of the concepts so you can have a look at it. It's not really anything useful at the moment, it's just a prototype. So use case for that is also email spam detection. That was also what was used in this blog post I mentioned. I initially wanted to do something different, like fingerprinting or using tweets. However, it's a bit tricky to get a data set that is interesting, large, publicly usable, and interesting. So tweets, when do tweets match? When someone retweets. So spam is actually a quite cool use case. Here I just took 2 months of these mails. These are 58,000 mails, and for that I chose N and K. So I thought, well, 16 million is quite larger than that. So we use 8 chunks, 24 bits, and need to compute about 192 hash functions. Also, if you look in min-hashing literature, they usually recommend to start around 200 hash functions. So if you want to try it out, that's a good place to start. So, and basically, how does the model look like? It's a rather forward implementation of what I just told you. We basically have start with a spout, which gives us all the emails. Then we have a tokenizer, which parses the MIME header and creates all the hashes and takes the bits and so on. So we end up with 8 chunks of 24 bit. They are then pushed to the next bolt, which then routes it to actually 8 parallel writers, so that each chunk here is modeled with 1 React bucket, and so we can write all chunks in parallel just to React. The key is rather simple. I wanted for this demo to have it a bit readable, so it's just an integer representation of all the chunks, and we store the whole hash under each in each bucket as a key. There's also a relation ID for this demo case. It's just the file name of the spam email where it did originate. And basically, to do the lookup, we use a React index. So we index, for instance, this first bucket, we would use the first chunk value as an index, for the next bucket, the next one, and so on. There are also indexes on the hash and the relation ID, just to make it a bit more practical, and that's basically all you need. We also store a timestamp and so on, but it's not relevant for this system. So let's have a short look at it. I have it. So that's basically a small part of the Storm topology, and it's basically what I just told you. It's this reading spout, it's this tokenizer, which takes the number of hash functions and chunks. Basically, here's this forwarding bolt, and then we use React Storm streams to connect the output of this routing bolt to our actual writers. And because it's a demo, we in parallel query everything we index in parallel from React. And we export some statistics to Redis because there's a small dashboard which I built so we can see what's happening in the algorithm. So we can now basically just run it. Some local config. We initialize all the hash functions, and then we just start to push the stuff into it. And hopefully this works. Let's close those. So here's the small dashboard. Can you see it completely? So here are a few statistics. So basically, the first number is how many of the spam mails we have already ingested into the topology. It stops at 3,000 because for this demo, it just ingests 3,000 emails. And then we see it basically the most load goes into writing into React. So we have to write the 3,000 keys in 8 buckets. So this number will be increasing until it's arrived at 3,000. And here's the number of lookups we have already finished. So it's just running on my MacBook, so the parallelization is all just a bit fun. But we can basically see that we can populate it and we can query and we have some kind of real-time view on the data. So at the top here is basically a graph which just takes the last 5 seconds and takes the biggest cluster it found in the last 5 seconds. So it's sometimes zero because it's a lot of load on the MacBook. And we see that the biggest cluster here is at about 10 similar emails, or no, it's 8 or 7, this is this cluster here. And the interesting thing is what happens if we look at how many comparisons are there per candidate set. And we see that there are actually very few actual comparisons done. And if we have many comparisons, then this is usually because we also have a cluster of that size. This might be a bit different in a production setting because you then have much more data and you have a much higher probability of having some collisions there. But basically, we can just ingest more data and don't run into a hell of doing comparisons. And also to give you a short look on what these emails look like, we can just have a quick look at those. So I just open 3 of these mails. And well, it's not so the best example. It's a base 46, 64 encoded email. And we see a few lines. However, if we switch between them, we see it's not exactly identical. The first line appears, it starts with QAA, and here it also starts with QAA, but in the middle, there's something different. And I tried this. If you decode it, you can also see the text is similar, but there are some different links in there and so on. And let's see what the last line, all of that. Maybe we have now a different cluster, which might be more interesting. Let's have a look at those. 38. Let's use those. No, it's still the same. Let's wait for a moment. Now we found one with 60 emails. That's a more interesting cluster, I can tell you. And so what actually happens here, we have some weird encoded multi-part message with, for example, here some strange value at supper@gmail.com and some weird user hashes and so on. And if we look here, we have a very similar email, but actually these strings will differ between these emails. So basically, that's working quite well. Let's just stop the heat on my MacBook. And so, well, basically what we can do many, or we can check for some kinds of duplicates. We cannot be too fussy about it, because if we want to have more fussiness, we need to create bigger bit distances to the chunks we want to look up. And even if we start with a distance of 2, it's already so many, and we have 24 bits and so on. We have so many variations that it's kind of getting slow. However, we get some way of fussiness. We don't have so much structuring about it. So if you really say, okay, we have a database or data where we have want to put much more emphasis on one feature, like with the weights we showed in the beginning, then you cannot incorporate that. But there are some ideas on how we can enforce some structure onto the data, so we can look at what could be other use cases for it. So one thing I mentioned is fingerprinting. Now, fingerprinting is, well, one thing, the thing is that you probably don't have so many tokens. So the general idea is that you blue up your smaller data, so you get many, many tokens, so that if some change, you still can match. And one way you could do this is to simply prefix your values with the actual keys. So for instance, if another field here would also have the word Mozilla in it, then we would have a different prefix and a different token, different hashes, and so on and so forth. And in the bottom, there's just a short diagram on we could get them with the JavaScript client, use some server broker, and push it in our Storm topology. So in the beginning, I mentioned sequence tracking or maybe actions where we would be interested in some behavior. So we could use a similar method and just prefix it by ordered step strings, for instance. And we could use some time windows and calculate some more metrics about it. The main point here is that probably other methods to do pattern mining will be better for actually mining the patterns. However, if we use such a scheme, we could have some kind of monitoring on special behaviors. We could see if something totally strange might happen. So there would probably be much more of a case for that system when it's about fraud or when we are interested in specific new interest in some totally new product, some new hype or whatever. So for practical pattern mining, it's probably not the most efficient thing, but if you want to have some monitoring on that, it could be quite helpful. And basically my famous topic, fraud at the end. As an example, we also don't have so much data. We might have emails. In our case, we did look a lot at emails, and you could basically blow an email up. So you have many tokens which you can use with this algorithm by just using multiple encodings. But I think it needs a bit of research on what you can do there and also some customization on what actually or on what data you can actually add to it. So you could think about tags and tagging each email and use timestamps or other information you have about the registration to put in using tags. And then you could see if there are many things that might come from the same or from the same people behind them. But it still needs some research. And with that, I come basically to the end of the talk. It's not really a finished product or something. As I said, the main idea of this talk is to get people more interested in the whole topic. Today, we have quite a good status, I'd say, for machine learning and search, for instance, where there have been research in the past, there have been a lot of paper, everyone calls it the same thing. You have libraries where you can explore which algorithms to use. And for this topic of finding or actually working with a focus on deduplication, there's research going on, there's no consolidated project and so on. So I hope if I can spark your interest in that, that might change someone in the future. So thank you. So I think we have a few minutes for questions. Any questions? This one here.
Thanks. One of the questions I had was concerning large documents. If you have large documents with a lot of features and you would like to deduplicate them, then you would have to make many calls for each feature. in the end offer each hash or for each feature you extracted?
Well, do you mean a long document in the sense of a long email with many, many words?
Yeah, or a web document or something like that.
That should actually work if you just use more hash functions. Mm-hmm. So if you use just 10 hash functions, then you get really, a large document or many documents will get you the same set of hashes. Mm-hmm. So this might be too not specific enough. Mm-hmm. But you then can choose just to use much more hashes. But what you can also do if you have really a lot of features, like different mm-hmm. columns of data, you can prefix them, like shown in the end,
yes,
and use the same method. It becomes a problem if you have a few large documents and a few short documents, and if your size varies a lot within your data set.
Mm-hmm. But in this case, you would still have the network traffic to check each document for existence. Or am I mistaken?
You must somehow, if you have the document, you must transfer it somewhere. Mm-hmm. But what you could do is at the source of the document,
yes,
where you have it, you could there do the tokenization and calculate the hashes and do the
still
bit sample.
Yes.
And then just forward the bit sample to the system. So
Have you considered using Bloom filters? Using them locally?
Not for this demo. Mm-hmm. Could be incorporated, of course. And well, it's a bit tricky question to ask to answer right off the way. I think it's a bit the thing about Bloom filters is that you put your things in there and then ask the Bloom filter, have you seen that? So you might get some false positives there, but in general you should know that. You could probably try that, but then also you only know if you have seen it. You don't get the exact duplicates and you don't get the size of how often you have seen it.
Mm-hmm.
So it depends a bit on the
use case.
On the use case, yes.
Okay, thank you.
More questions? There's one behind.
How did you exactly benefit from using Apache Storm? Anything specific Apache Storm or anything specific about the topology?
I mostly do stuff with Storm, so it was my first choice there. It's, of course, not specific to Apache Storm. What's useful about it is that you can... My aim was to see if I could at least have a prototype where I could put a stream of data in, and where I would get those spikes that might be interesting. And for such a long-running computation, Storm is a good fit. Of course, there are other similar projects like SAMSA or Spark Streaming and so on. And basically what I like about Storm is that it was one of the first of the systems which was on the market. And we also do some work where the actual components are not implemented in Java, but other languages. And that's their Storm is the only way where this is working really well. SAMSA said that they planned for multi-language features, but it's not yet there. And so I'm, for practical reasons, a fan of Storm. And of course, you could also question the use of React. If you, for instance, in this case, if we bound our data amount to 16 million, it's probably not super interesting to do it in React. You could do it in Redis and be much faster, I think. What you could also do is, I'm not fully sure if it's completely possible, but you could write a tokenizer which does the stuff for Elasticsearch, for instance, and then just store the bit samples in Elasticsearch. Not sure how the lookup would then really look like, but then you would not have this continuously ingesting and querying thing. So you have to have something which runs all the time.
I'm not sure if I'm... Oh, it's very loud. I'm not sure if I'm right, but as far as I understood that when you have very large duplicate sets, then you have an end-to-end comparison for each of the duplicate sets. You have like every document is compared to every other. So have you ever thought about, okay, what is Well, first of all, okay, the impact is pretty clear. If you have very large sets of emails, so to say, that, then probably the algorithm gets attractive. So have you thought about using like transitivity, the transitivity property, to get rid of this problem? So because if you do that on a long run, and yeah. you put like millions or trillions of emails in, then probably the algorithm will slow down over time.
Well, it basically it will mainly slow. I'm not fully sure if I really get your question, to be honest. The thing is that you have to do a lot of comparisons. If behind one chunk you have really a lot of messages, and that mainly happens if you have a cluster that is really, really big. So if you have data where 90% of your data is actually a duplicate of itself, then in this naive implementation, you would just keep on pushing the data into the same cluster and always comparing all the data with each other. That's one of the edge cases that could happen. But then you would have basically just one big cluster and not much use of the system. For transitivity, probably you could, well, it's just a naive implementation of the algorithm. Once you have identified one cluster, you could, of course, store some identification of the cluster, which would also be helpful to know, do I know this cluster before? That's not done by the prototype I showed you. It just says, now I found this cluster, and there's these 60 or however items in it. If then the next item comes, I don't know if I have seen that cluster before, and that would be interesting to know if it's new or if something has changed and so on. So we would need to add something to that. And basically, that could be something to use Bloom filters for instance. Okay. So if it didn't answer your question, we can talk afterwards, I think. Not sure what you meant, really.
Yeah, that answers my question.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
I have one question in general about the duplication. Is your system working the same when there are many duplicate data than when there are only a very small subset that are duplicate? Is it this?
I'm not really sure I get.
So imagine we have two types of data set. One data set with many duplicate things,
yeah.
and the other that have only small part of it that are
yeah.
duplicate. Is it,
do you
approach it the same way or is it different?
Yeah, you mean, do you mean running the same algorithm for each data set specifically or do you mean you run the algorithm and you have two data sets and you mix them and put them in there?
No, if you have two different data set with different characteristics.
Yes.
One with a lot of duplicate
sure.
and the other with...
And do I put both data, do I put data from both data sets in the same system or do I have the system
separately.
Twice with different configurations?
Separately, whether...
Separately. Yeah, if you have that case, then you should have... You need to do some tuning with this amount of the number of hashes you calculate, the number of bits you have, and the number of chunks you divide it into. And if you have two data sets that are widely different, you should tune these values to fit your data set. You could try it more general way and put both data set into the same system, but probably you would then only find duplicates for the data set where you have many of them. Also, the number of bits you use, as we have seen, 90% difference would equal in the 32-bit case to 4 bits that are different. And if you do a larger, and because with 32 or with chunks of 8 bits, you cannot process much or really a lot amount of data. So you have to have larger chunks, like starting at 20 bits to 40 should be a good range. And if you then have only a few chunks, then if you have like 4 chunks and you have 4 unequal bits, this will be much less than 90 or much more than 90%. So your fuzziness would be limited by that. So if you do that, you would, for instance, then have always matches only if you have a equality or a matching of like 79% or so. In the case with the 24 bits, if I remember correctly, it's 98.5%, which must match, so you find it. So that's how you tune it, and that's the empirical part about it still. Not sure. I think we have time for one more question. There does not seem to be a question. So thank you. If you are still or should come to mind with another question, you can find me around. And thanks a lot for your attention.